So, hello students. So today we are taking the electrostatics for electrostatic potential and capacitor, and here we'll deal with the topic potential energy in an external field. So, potential energy of a single charge. So, there are many different consequences here. The potential energy in an external field. So first of all, it is for the potential energy of a single charge. Then we will see the potential energy of the system of charges in an external field. Okay, and the torque, the potential energy of a dipole in the in an external field. So these three situations we are going to see. Okay, and then we will go to the electrostatics of the conductors. Okay, in electrostatics of conductors, we'll see inside a conductor, electrostatic field is zero. At surface of a charged conductor, electrostatic field must be normal to the surface at every point. Then comes the interior of a conductor. Interior of the conductor can have no excess charge in the static situation. Then fourth consequence is the electrostatic potential is constant throughout the volume of the conductor and has the same value as on its surface. Then we will see the electric field at the surface of a charged conductor is E vector equal to sigma by epsilon naught n cap. Okay, then we'll go to the electrostatic shielding. Okay, so beginning with the potential energy in an external field. So what it says, so if it is a single charge of the if it is a single charge, what happens is, so suppose this is a charge Q. Now the charge has its own field, the electric field. Okay, so if it is positive charge, the electric field lines will be moving outwards, right? So if it is a negative charge, it will the electric field lines will be moving inwards. Okay, so this is the basic characteristic of the charge. Okay, so now we are taking the positive charge for our reference. So consider a region of space around a charge or a system of charges which may be which may be known or unknown. Okay, they are known or unknown, and here space around the charge is the electric field. So let vector E and B may vary from point to point. So as we move from away from the charge, the electric field and the potential varies from one point to another point. But if it is on the same surface, then it will be same. Okay, then the potential V at any point P is the work done in bringing a unit positive charge from infinity to a point. The potential P at the potential V at any point is, so suppose here is the charge, suppose this is a charge and here is a point P. So this charge should be brought from one, some, suppose this is a infinity, we don't know the distance, actual distance of this charge. So from here to this point, we have to bring this positive charge. So some work is to be done. So that work is stored as the potential energy. That's what we are finding here. The potential V at any point P is a work done in bringing a unit positive charge from infinity to the point. Therefore, work done in bringing a charge from Q to a point is given by Q into V. This is work, and this work is stored in the form of potential energy. Okay, this is the work, this work is stored in the form of potential energy, and therefore this potential energy is given by, so from this point in from infinity to a point P, the charge is moved. So the what work is done, that is stored as a potential energy. So here Q is the magnitude of the charge, and let us see the V as a potential. So potential energy is given by Q, the product of the charge into potential. Okay, consider this as equation number 1. Therefore, now we will see the value here. What will be the value of the energy? Okay, so suppose if we know that in the first chapter itself, the magnitude of the charge, that is Q equal to 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb, then a small amount of the potential difference is from one point to another point is 1 volt. Let us consider. Okay, now U equal to Q dV equal to Q value is 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb, and this is dV is 1 volt. Okay, and here 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 joule. This energy, this unit of energy is defined as 1 electron volt or 1 EV. Thus, 1 EV is equal to 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 joule. So, this is the potential energy of a single charge. Potential energy of a system of two charges in an external field. So here let V and V1 and V2 be the potentials due to the due to an external field at two points separated by distance r. So now let us consider two charges Q1 and Q2. These two charges are separated by a distance r. So next, let us see what happens. Now first let us consider only one charge, that is Q1. This Q1 is again brought from some place from infinity. This charge Q1 is brought from a very far distance that we don't know. That is, let us consider the distance r, the point as from infinity, and it is made to stand here or position here at Q1, okay, from a Q2. So the potential, the work done against the external field, so there is an external field of Q2, so therefore work done against this field is equal to Q1 V1. So therefore the work done against the external field is Q1 V1. Now another charge Q2 is brought, from infinity to and placed at a certain at another point where the external potential is V2. Now work done is V2 Q2, and here so for the second charge also the similar thing we will calculate, that is V2 Q2 we will get. Now the work done on Q2 against the field due to Q1, so the work done for Q2 due to the field of Q1, so what will be the work done here? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by R. So here again, so already there we have brought Q1 here, and another charge Q2 is also brought here. So the for the work done between these two, that is to bring this, suppose this was a positive charge Q2 and this was also a positive charge Q1, so now there is repulsive force. So work done is done against this repulsive force to bring this Q2 at a certain point near Q1. Okay, so therefore work done will be one upon 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2. So we have to write the product of these two charges divided by R. So this is a work done in bringing a another charge Q2 from a certain from infinity to a certain point at a distance r from q1. So therefore, now total work done. So what we have to do is we have to add this work done and this one due to the two charges. So q2 qv2 plus, so therefore total work done will be total work done is equal to q2 v2 plus 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. Hope you are seeing. You can see q1 q2 by r. So this is the total work done. Okay, now so now it is between these two. So what about this individual? So therefore again energy u is equal to q1 v1 plus q2 v2 plus 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 by r. So this is the total potential energy due to the two charges. So let us consider this as equation number 1. Now let us go to the potential energy due to the dipole. Consider a dipole with the charges q1 plus q and minus q. So dipole means it is a pair of charges, a positive and negative charge, which is separated by a small distance 2a. So from this we will get the dipole moment p is equal to q into 2a. Let the dipole be placed in a uniform electric field. Now these pink lines, dotted lines we are showing. So this is the electric field in which the dipole is placed. A dipole is placed here and this is a uniform electric field. Okay. Now the angle made between the dipole and the field is theta. And P is the dipole moment. Okay. Now, what happens is the force is created, force is exerted on the dipole due to the electric field as well. And so, when there is a force on this field, on this dipole, so now here I'll show you. So, suppose there is a uniform electric field. And if this is a dipole, so this is minus and this is plus. So now the force of this will be in this manner inward F into Q. So equal and opposite it will be, hence there will be torque created on the dipole. So this torque is given by tau equal to P cross E. Okay. Now this P cross E is can be written as tau equal to P E sine theta. So it is a cross product. So tau equal to, tau is what? It is the torque experienced by the dipole in the presence of the external field. Okay, so now in a uniform electric field vector E with its dipole moment P vector making an angle theta with the direction of electric field E, the net force experienced by the dipole is zero. So here equal and opposite forces are there, hence the net force experienced by it is zero, but there will be torque, that means it will be move oscillating there. So tau equal to P vector cross E vector. So the tau equal to P sine theta. Now, so let us see now what is the work done on that dipole. This torque will tend to rotate the dipole and also and align it with the electric field. The torque is tend to align with the electric field. The external torque neutralizes the torque of the dipole and rotates the dipole through a small angle d theta. without angular acceleration. So the dipole also tends to rotate, and in the presence of electric field also the torque, the dipole will be rotated by the external electric field. So what happens is it will have a certain angle, little it tries to neutralize the torque of the dipole, and through a small angle d theta without angular acceleration, it will not accelerate, allow the dipole to accelerate. So therefore small amount of work is done during this process. Therefore dw equal to tau d theta, so it will give pe sin theta d theta. Therefore total work done in rotating the dipole from orientation theta 1 to theta 2 is w equal to, so we will integrate here. So here what happens is dw equal to tau into d theta, so this will be pe sin theta d theta. So it will tend to rotate between two intervals. So now integration of dw is w. Now here will be theta 1 to theta 2 pe sin theta. So pe we will get it outside, minus sin, integration of sin theta is minus cos theta between the limits theta 1 and theta 2. So here what we get is pe, so we'll take minus outside, cos theta 2 minus cos theta 1. Now let us consider two angles here. The torque is rotated through two angles, that is theta 1 equal to pi by 2 and theta 2 is equal to theta. So therefore work done is equal to integration of pi by 2 into theta pe sin theta d theta. So this is equal to, again here integration of sin theta is again minus cos minus it is, so therefore it will be pe, so it is minus, here it becomes plus, minus cos theta. So it is pi by 2 to theta, and here w equal to minus p cos of theta minus cos of pi by 2. So here cos pi by 2 is 0, right? Cos of 90 is 0, right? So therefore what you get is minus p cos theta, this value becomes 0, cos of 90 becomes 0. Okay, so therefore w equal to minus p cos theta. So this is the magnitude of the dot products, of that is p dot e minus p dot e. So this is the work done. So work done is stored as the potential energy, therefore u is equal to minus p dot e. So this is the energy of the torque. So in vector form you can write it as u is equal to minus of p vector dot e vector. Okay. This is the potential energy due to the dipole in an external electric field. Okay, so now let us go to, I think you have understood this one, so that's what we have here. U equals minus PE cos theta minus P dot vector. So therefore this is the potential energy of a dipole. Okay, now let us go to the electrostatics of conductors. So now what are the conductors? So conductors are the substances which allow electric field which allow the electric charges to pass through it. Okay, so conductors contain mobile charges, or these mobile charges are known as the electrons. Okay, in metals, the outer valence electrons part away from their atoms, but not free to move out or leave the metal. So in metals, there are outer electrons which are little bit free from the hold of the or force of attraction from the nucleus, but they are not so much free to move outside the metal. Okay, so in order to remove an electron, you have to give the so much of energy that it has to overcome. It should be greater than the nuclear force. Okay, and so therefore these electrons form a kind of gas. So now that means if you are giving a little bit of energy to it, it will just move about its own axis, just oscillate there, and they collide with each other with the ions and move randomly in different directions. In an external field, they drift against the direction of the field. In electrolytic conductors, the charge carriers are both positive and negative ions. So now let us see the consequences here, some of the situations here. Particularly, inside a conductor, electrostatic field is zero. So now inside a conductor, electrostatic field is zero. So already we have known from the Gauss law that inside the conductor, there are no free charges. Free charges will be only on the outer shell, so outermost shell. Okay, but they are free, but not so much free that they can move out of the or leave the atom itself. So if the electric field is not zero, if it was not zero, then inside the conductor, the charge carriers will experience a force, and the charge carriers will experience a force and drift. In static situation, when there is no current inside or on the surface of the conductor, the electric field inside the conductor is zero. This is true whether the conductor is charged or neutral, whether there is external electric field or not. So in static situation, the charges are not in motion, hence there is no current. Hence when there is no current, there is no current inside the conductor also. So therefore inside the conductor, electrostatic field is zero. Now let us go to the second one. At the surface of the charged conductor, electrostatic field must be normal to the surface. So now, for example, let us consider, so suppose this is the conductor of any shape you can take. Now here is a charge Q, so the electric field lines will always be normal. So suppose we take this surface here, so the electric field line will be make 90 degree to the, when you draw the tangent to the surface. So if it was not perpendicular, so if suppose if it was in this direction, so makes a certain angle like 30 degree or 20 degree, okay, less than 90 degree. Now if it was so, then it would have made some component which gives rise to a again free it experiences a force and move. Okay, so if it was the component here, if it was an angle lesser than the 90 degree, then what would happen is it would experience a force and just move. So this is motion of the charges is not studied in the electrostatics, hence this second point is also True. So that means thus at the surface of the charge conductor, the electrostatic field must be normal to the surface at every point. So wherever you take on this surface, if you are taking the point at this surface, okay, so always it will be normal. So wherever you take on this surface, it will be normal. If you take any irregular shape also, suppose this is a surface, it is normal. Okay, so that is now 90 degree. Normal means 90 degree. Free charges on the surface of the conductor would then experience force and move, but in static situation there is no current on the surface of the conductor and electric field should have no component along the surface of the conductor. Hence electric field E must be along the normal to the surface at every point. Now let us go to the interior of the conductor can have no excess charge in the static situation. Again the same thing here, the third one. Inside the in the interior of the of a conductor can have no excess charge in the static situation. So here if the the conductor is static, and if and we already know from the electrostatics that the charges, free charges reside only on the surface, that too like the gas molecules, they just collide with each other, they will not move. So this point you have to be very very clear when you are dealing with the first two chapters, that is the electrostatic charge and field, and the next one this lesson, the electrostatic potential and capacitor. So on the close, so according to Gauss law, the electric field inside the sphere, what we have studied the application in the first chapter, inside the surface there are no excess of charges. So when there are no excess of charges, electric field will be zero. The flux is also, electric flux is zero. Hope I have, you have clear with this point. So let us go to the fourth situation here. Electrostatic potential is constant throughout the volume of the conductor and has the same value as on its surface. So potential is constant, inside it electric field is zero, on the surface it will be always constant. Okay, so as it is normal to the surface, the potential will also be constant. So as you have seen, for equipotential surfaces, the potential difference on the equipotential surface is zero. Therefore, on the surface is same. On the surface, if you take any two points and suppose here this is a equipotential surface, okay? So for this is the radius and this is the equipotential surface. So if you take V1 and V2 here, so delta V is equal to V2 minus V1. So here the difference will be zero. At V2 also suppose you get 2 volt and V1 is also 2 volt. Difference between these 2 minus 2 is zero. So that is what the potential difference is, constant everywhere on the equipotential surface. Now electric field at the surface of a charged conductor is E vector equal to sigma by epsilon naught n cap. So suppose there is a diagram here, I have written in pink pen, hope you can, it is visible. So here there is a irregular shape of a conductor and there is a pill box. So pill half it the partly part of a pill box is inside the conductor and the other half is outside the conductor. So the charges are residing on this surface and n cap is the unit vector. E gives the electric field through this cylinder. So now sigma is the surface charge density, n cap is the unit vector normal to the surface. A cylinder or a pill box is chosen as the Gaussian surface. Now ds is the area of cross section of this pill box. So if you cut a slide of a pillbox. So ds will be the surface cross section area of the pillbox. So inside the surface electric field is zero. So ds is the area of this one. So from the Gauss law we have phi equal to plus or minus E ds. That is, it may, the charges may be positive, charges may be negative. So E plus or minus E into ds. So from Gauss law what we have, equation phi equal to sigma ds by epsilon naught. So we will equate these two, electric flux and also from Gauss law we will equate. Okay, so E ds equal to sigma ds by epsilon naught. So ds and ds gets cancelled, E equal to sigma by epsilon naught. So in vector form we have vector E equal to sigma by epsilon naught into n cap. So this is the five situations of the electrostatics electrostatics of conductors. So here one more important topic is the electrostatic shielding. Shielding is to protect. Okay, so what is the electrostatic shielding is? So to protect from the electrostatic charges, what we have to protect is the conductors. Okay, not us. Us also, when we are in open air or from the lightning, from the natural disasters. So in order to protect us, we have to be under a strong surface. So how that is work, how it works, that we will discuss here in electrostatic shielding. Okay, so first of all, what is, we have to understand what is meant by electrostatic shielding. Electrostatic shielding is a phenomena of protecting a certain part of a conductor from the electric field. This is done by making a cavity inside the conductor. So inside the conductor, in the cavity, electric field will be zero, surface charge density will also be zero. Because there are no charges, electric field will be zero, and what will be the potential there? It will be V naught. So as there are no charges, so potential will also be zero. Now the conductor remains protected inside when there is no electric field outside. So if you are traveling in a car or a bus, okay, so if there is lightning also, you will be protected inside the bus or the car, because on the surface only the charges will be residing. So here in the diagram you can see the charges are there. Okay, if you are in the building also, if there is strong lightning and thunder, you protect yourself under the roof, a strong roof. So if it is not strong, then it is a very bad sign that you will be hit by the lightning. So but if the roof is strong, then it will not hit you, you'll be safe. So this is known as the electrostatic shielding. Okay, so hope you have understood these topics. So these are very, very important topics. So go through the topics. Thank you.